Well, here we are with David Rubenstein, Chair of the Board of Trustees of Duke University. Welcome, David, to your law school. I know you think University of Chicago is your law school, but I hate to tell you that from the point of view of your fiduciary obligations, we are your law school.
Well, it's your fault that I went to Chicago because your father was the dean of the University of Chicago Law School at one point. He did such a good job that it attracted people to give scholarship money. And when I was an undergraduate at Duke, I graduated in 1970. I applied to lots of law schools, and whoever gave me the biggest scholarship, that's where I was going. And Duke accepted me, and I was thinking probably coming here, and then University of Chicago showed up with a full scholarship. And I said, you know, my father made $7,000 a year. He worked in the post office. This was a full scholarship, so I'd never been west of probably Durham, North Carolina. But I had never been to Chicago. I accepted it. Unfortunately, I had so little money in those days that they said, if you want your position and the scholarship, you know, send in your $50 to reserve your place. That seems reasonable. And then another letter came and said, send in your $50 to reserve your housing. I said, well, geez, why would I want to waste $50 twice? I would just send in one $50. I'll send it to the housing people. They will obviously tell the law school I'm showing. Why would I need housing if I'm going to go to law school? So sure enough, I show up there the day of registration, and the law school people said, well, you never send your $50 in. Your scholarship went away.
There you go.
That's so Chicago. The blood drained out.
That's law and economics
your father's
right
policies.
There.
I didn't realize he was that harsh. So the blood drained out, and I thought, oh, it's too late. All the other schools started. So I was ready to cry. I didn't get the scholarship. Then they came back and said, okay, we found the money. We'll give you the money. And so I went there, and in gratitude, I gave him $20 million in scholarship money recently. Oh,
I know you did that. That upset me no end. You've seen this slide where I say that Duke Law School, and then I have this little guy with a telescope, and it says he's looking for a ruby.
Right.
So, you know, because that's what they call this scholarship, right. A ruby. And we have Stan Starr. These are things that, Starr, ruby, these are things that shimmer. We like things that shimmer,
okay.
David.
Well, it's really just bribery. I mean, we basically bribe people to go to the law school, right? So you give a full ride, and people tend to show up. And so okay. It works. It worked with me, and it works with the people now.
So you grew up in Baltimore, and you said your dad was a postal worker.
Yeah, your father was, you know, one of the most distinguished scholars in the country, and he was attorney general, president of the university, dean of the law school, an extraordinary man. My father, you know, just because your last name is Jewish doesn't mean you're extraordinary the way your father was. There are blue-collar Jews, and my father was one of them. My father dropped out of high school to go into World War II. He came back, he met my mother, who also dropped out of high school to get married, and I was the only child. My father had no education, so he worked in the post office for his entire life, made about $7,000 a year.
I didn't like the way you started that, though. It was like the curves were crossing
or
something.
But, that's the great thing about this country. Your father was one of the most distinguished people in the world. I believed in the American system or that you could rise up from very modest circumstances. So I got very lucky, a lot of hard work and so forth. And I grew up in a pretty much segregated area, too, because Baltimore was the most rigidly segregated city in the United States by religion. The Jews in Baltimore were not allowed to buy homes in non-Jewish areas. The mortgages forbade you to do so, and blacks as well. And it was outlawed by the Supreme Court, I think, Shelley v. Kramer in 48, but it didn't get to Baltimore. The word didn't get to Baltimore for a while. They were still having these restrictive covenants, and so all the Jews had to live in one area. And so I didn't know anybody who wasn't Jewish until I was about 13. And I thought everybody in the world's Jewish. Then later I realized virtually nobody's Jewish. But
why'd you come to Duke?
I was an equal opportunity applier to college as well. I applied to lots of colleges, and whoever gave me the biggest scholarship, that's where I was going. So Duke felt sorry for me that I needed a scholarship. They gave me a big scholarship, and I came here. Again, I'd never been to North Carolina, never been to Duke, and I wasn't sure it was really my type of place because the insignia of the school, the seal, official seal, and all the things had a gigantic cross. And I said, geez, it didn't seem like it was that welcoming to me, but, and the truth is that there was a Jewish quota in those days. Many schools had informal Jewish quotas, and Duke had one as well. I now learned it was roughly a 5% Jewish quota. And and Terry Sanford, when he became president in 1969, heard about it and got rid of it right away. But when I applied to Duke, I graduated in high school in 66. Duke only desegregated for undergraduates in 63. So when I showed up, my college class here had 12 African Americans and a very limited number of Jews. And it was different because I went to a big public high school, which was half black and half Jewish. And you know, when I got here, I said, like, wow, this is a different world. It was, and you know, I didn't do that well in the beginning because in those days you had a, for freshmen, you were supposed to learn the traditions, the customs of the university, and they had tests on it and so forth. And I couldn't understand the accent of the people talking to me. They had this deep Southern accent, and I didn't know what they were talking about. But anyway, I survived and did okay.
Did you paint your face blue and jump up and down?
No. In those days, Duke basketball wasn't quite what it has become since. And in those days, I said the only way that I'm going to get ahead is probably not by, you know, going to a lot of parties and things like that, but going to the library. So I just went to the library mostly, and I studied and tried to get the best grades I could. So I wasn't, you know, I wasn't that athletic. I was the only person, I think, in Duke's history who, as an undergraduate, got cut from an intramural basketball team when there were only four other people on the team. And, you know, I was not invited. I didn't join a fraternity. I wasn't even invited to go to join a fraternity. And so I, you know, I basically just studied and tried to not get in trouble.
Ah, sounds very sad. This is like
you didn't do the same?
I studied a lot. We had a guy here called Iron Butt who became the president of the United States, and your stories sound very similar.
Well, he got a scholarship. That's why he came across the country, and he did some things that I'm not sure I would have done.
No,
but
I think you know it kind of caught up with him. So you go to Chicago, and then you practice law in.
Well, I had no interest in making money. You know, when you grow up in a modest family. My mother had the F. Scott Fitzgerald view that rich people are just a different species, essentially, and they're different. And she didn't really, she wanted me to be a dentist. She thought that was the highest calling of mankind. You get to be called a doctor, no, you know, crazy hours and so forth. And she'd had a lot of dental work, so she just thought it was a really good thing. Suppose I get arthritis in my fingers, what will I do? My career will be over. So I talked her out of that. And I was really seriously interested in public service and helping the country. When I was in the sixth grade, John Kennedy gave a very famous speech, his inaugural address, which was only 14 minutes. It was a brilliantly given speech, the best speech he ever gave by far. And he said, of course, ask not what you can do for your country. So I thought I would try to help my country. And ultimately, when I graduated from law school, I wanted to go work in a law firm in New York where the man who wrote that speech, Ted Sorensen, was working. And he was, in my view, the greatest presidential speechwriter of all time. Brilliant writer. In those days, they kind of downplayed his writing abilities because John Kennedy was not considered to be that intellectually gifted, and they didn't want the people around him to have people think people were writing all of his things. So the truth is Sorensen was really writing them. But I went to work for Sorensen on the theory that he could get me a job maybe at some point using his contacts to work in the White House. And you know, I practiced law for a couple years at Paul Weiss, which was an unusual law firm in those days in New York. It was half Jewish and half not Jewish. In those days, that was relatively rare. I had spent a summer at Cravath, Swain & Moore, which was, you know, a little waspier, I would say.
Not so much half and half.
It was waspier. And I never forgot, I was so out of, I mean, I come from a blue-collar background, so I'm Cravath, Swain & Moore, the fanciest Wall Street firm in the time, and I got a summer job there. I was the highest salary that I'd ever imagined, $300 a week, which was a lot for then. And so I shared an office with a guy in those days, and I never forget his office, his name. It was very typical of that firm. His name was Francis R. Snodgrass III. So anyway, I get there the first day, and I take off my jacket. And the guy, known as Tony Snodgrass, said, "What the hell is that?" I said, "What do you mean?" He says, "I've never seen a short sleeve white shirt before in Wall Street." I said, "Well, it's summer. Don't you wear short sleeves?" He says, "We have air conditioning here." So in Baltimore, my father, when you worked in the summer, you had a short sleeve shirt. So I bought 12 short sleeve white shirts that work, and then, of course, you don't have to do that, so I had to throw them all away. But I worked.
Were you wearing shorts?
No, I didn't do that. But I, I my handwriting was so bad that I always would type everything, and then the head of the firm saw me typing one day, and he says, "What the hell is that about?" And I said, "Well, I'm typing. I can do it better." He says, "We're paying the secretary $7 an hour. We're paying you $50 an hour. I don't want to see you type anymore." So I got out of typing, but I decided not to go back there.
But now you're glad you type.
I'm glad I learned how to type. Yeah. But so I went to Paul Weiss, and after a couple years there, I said to Ted Sorensen, "I'd like to do something else." And he said, "Well, let me check around." And he came back and said, "You know, the other people here think it would be a good idea for maybe you to do something else." And I talked to my clients, and they said, "Well, I said I might be leaving. I want to go to do something to help the country." They said, "That would be a good idea." So I left after just 2 years. I'm in practice 2 years. And Ted Sorensen made some calls, and he got me a job with a man who he said would be the next president of the United States, and I would probably wind up in the White House someday. Unfortunately, it was a man named Senator Birch Bayh, who was running for president in 76. As you may know, he didn't get elected president. In fact, 30 days after I joined his staff, he dropped out. So I thought, uh-oh, I wasn't a great lawyer, and I wasn't a great political prognosticator. And this will happen to some of you. You get a call out of the blue from somebody you didn't know, and it can change your life. So I got a call out of the blue from somebody I'd never heard of before, and I don't even remember his name now. And he said, "Would you like to interview with somebody else running for president of the United States?" I said, "All right, who is this?" And he said, "Jimmy Carter." I said, "Oh, that's the peanut farmer from Georgia, right?" I said, "Yes." He said, "He's going to be the nominee." I said, "Well, I doubt it." But anyway, I got an interview, and ultimately I went to the general election part of the campaign, and I went down there when after he got the nomination. And as Carter likes to remind me, when I joined his campaign in June of 76, he was 33 points ahead of Gerald Ford, and he won by 1 point. So Carter said, like, "What was your contribution here?" But White House staffs are not filled on merit. They're filled on who worked in the campaign, and I worked in the campaign. So at 27 years old, 3 years out of the University of Chicago Law School, I became the Deputy Domestic Policy Advisor to the President of the United States.
That's pretty good. Now, you were so nice about my father, but right? The fact of the matter is that because of you, he lost his job.
That's true. but I assure you, it wasn't because of anything I did.
So there you were in the White House.
The campaign had been 1 week longer, he probably would have stayed, but because we were going down. I wasn't qualified to be the Deputy Domestic Policy Advisor at 27, but I thought Carter wasn't qualified to be president either. He didn't. He was a governor of Georgia 4 years. He didn't know anything about Washington, and nobody else in the staff seemed to know anything. So I, you know, one of the jobs I had was to fight inflation. I got it to 19%. Very difficult to do. Nobody has done it since. Carter,
we just might pause on that for a moment because, you know, looking around the room, a bit. 19%. I mean, that was what you could get a mortgage at like 19%, 21%.
I've said to people at the Fed recent years, if deflation is your problem, bring me back in the government because I can solve that deflation problem.
Okay.
But yeah. So at Carter, there was a rumor that I would be the senior domestic policy advisor if Carter was reelected. I would then be 31, the same age as Ted Sorensen. Ted Sorensen was 31 when he was the top advisor to President Kennedy, and actually, hard to believe, Jackie Kennedy was the first lady. She was only 31 years old. On the strength of that rumor that I would be the top domestic advisor, Carter thinks he lost the election. So I had to go out and practice law. And some of you will have this unfortunate experience. It was the worst professional experience of my life. One day, I am riding around on Air Force One, advising the president. I'm going to Camp David, preparing him for debates. I am preparing him for press conferences. I am going on Marine One, which is the helicopter. And believe me, there's no greater thrill having your parents, who have very modest aspirations for you, standing on the South Lawn with a lot of people. You're walking out of the Oval Office with the president, just you and the president, and the president is talking to you. You get on Marine One, which is a helicopter, and you fly off. That's a pretty good kick. Unfortunately, people who interview for jobs after you lose an election, they don't care that about any of these things. So one day, I'm at the top of the world, advising the president of the United States. We lose the election. All these people said to me, "You're a bright young man. When you want to practice law, call me up." I started calling all these people, and none of them would call me back, because who wants to know what a Carter White House aide thinks after Reagan is elected? So it took me a long time to get a job, because I thought I should be a partner in a major firm, or I should be doing great things, and nobody thought I should be. So I had to start my entire career over again. It took me about 4 or 5 months to convince any law firm in Washington that I was worthy of anything. And so I started off at the bottom again. I started with not a very famous firm, and I just started pretty much as a bottom-level associate, more or less, mid-level, and I worked my way up. And you know, after a couple of years, I looked around and said, if you don't love what you're doing, you can't be great at it. Nobody's ever won a Nobel Prize 9 to 5, 5 days a week on something they don't like. If you're going to change the world and do something useful or make your life pleasurable, you have to love what you're doing for most of your professional life. And I hated practicing law because I wasn't that good at it. And the real reason I wasn't that good at it is the years that you learn how to be a good lawyer are the years that I was in the White House. So my peers were still at Paul Weiss or comparable firms. They were learning the skills of a young lawyer. I was running around with the president. And while it was more fun than their fun, when I was ready to go practice law again, I didn't have the real skills of a lawyer. And so I did figure out one thing, and this was that the legal world, and it's obviously this way too, the legal world has become a business, and it was becoming then. And it wasn't so much a profession as I had thought it would be. And so I realized the way the law firm was set up, if you bring in business, you get compensated better than if you do the business and you don't bring it in. So I said, okay, I don't really have any great legal skills, but if I can go out and market the law firm and sell my colleagues' skills, I can bring in business and I will be the client getter. So I made myself into a bit of a salesman, telling everybody why, you know, my peers in the law firm were, you know, Clarence Darrow or Edward Bennett Williams or whatever the equivalent of that. And so I made a reasonable amount of money just selling the law firm, but I really didn't do that much practicing law because I wasn't really skilled.
So that suggests that now, if you wanted to, you could be a fantastic lawyer because you could bring your own business to the firm.
Well, now I could. Now I could. We pay out about $200 million a year in legal fees.
Sounds pretty good.
So I did that for a while, and then here's what happened. To be very serious, I didn't really enjoy it. And when you leave Washington, if you're in the White House, most people who work in the White House, and there's only been one other person and I who've ever worked in the White House and gone out and made a fair amount of money, and the other person is a very, very successful businessman in Utah and built a big company, and he worked for Richard Nixon. But generally, people who leave the White House, they say, okay, I love the White House, I love the environment of government, I'll be a lawyer lobbyist, and the next administration of your party, you'll go back in and successively higher positions, and eventually you'll, you know, maybe be Secretary of Transportation or something. So the life I should have had. And what happened was I realized that I didn't like practicing law, and I didn't really want to do what Washington lawyer lobbies do, which is raise money for politicians. So they don't only do that, but that was kind of having worked in government, that's what people probably expected I would do. So I read about a man named Bill Simon, who had been Secretary of the Treasury under Gerald Ford, under your father's administration. And he went out and bought a company after he left the Secretary of Treasury called Gibson Greeting Cards. And he bought it from RCA, and he paid, let's say, $230 million. He put in $1 million of his own money in this then called leverage buyout. And he made $80 million on his $1 million investment in about 2 years. I read that and said, that's better than practicing law. I like that.
I can do that.
So I went down the street to a man named Bill Miller, who had been Secretary of Treasury in the Carter years, and said, look, this man who was your predecessor, he made a lot of money. You're a smart guy, and you're also chairman of the Fed. Why don't you form a firm to do buyouts, and I'll help you. I'll do some legal work or something. And I convinced him to start the firm, but it didn't get anywhere. So finally, I decided I would start my own leverage buyout firm in Washington, the only one in existence in Washington at the time. And then I decided to do it because I read an article that said, on average, an entrepreneur will start his first company between the ages of 28 and 37. And like a woman's biological time clock going down this way, your chance of reproducing goes down, your chance of starting a company reduces at the age of 37. Your chance of you're starting it is possible, but much reduced. I read that when I was 37. I said, if I'm going to do something entrepreneurial and get out of the practice of law, I should do it. And I decided to start the first buyout firm in Washington. I raised $5 million to get it started, and I recruited three people who actually had some finance experience, and we started the firm.
That was very gutsy, if you think about it.
Stupid, but gutsy,
well,
yes.
Well, I mean, so you're not risk-averse.
Well, I'd say I felt I wasn't going to be a great lawyer. I didn't have, you know, the skill set to be a great lawyer. I wasn't going to be probably going back into government. I didn't really want to just go back in government and successfully modest. I had so much power as a young man, I figured I just probably couldn't replicate that and get a better job. So I decided to change, and it took off. Most people who start companies, 99.9% of all companies started do not make it. So, the people who do start companies that are successful, none of them really think that, A, they're going to build Microsoft or Amazon or Apple. None of them really. They think they're going to have a nice little company. In my case, when I started the company, I negotiated the lease. I was told that I took like 4,000 square feet. I was told I had a 4,000 additional square feet that comes automatically as an option. I said, take it out of the lease. I don't want to ever expand beyond 4,000. I'm only going to have 10 people, never bigger than that. So I didn't have any great vision of what we were going to do. And I can describe later how it took off and became more or less the biggest in the world. But it wasn't something I foresaw. Also, I would say to people who want to start business, if you are obsessed with making money, you aren't likely to make money. The people that build great companies, and I would say of the 80% of the people in the Forbes 400 who are people who made it on their own, those people, 95% of them, maybe 99%, built a company that had a service or a product they really believed in. They wanted to prove it was a good service or product, and they worked hard to prove it. They weren't obsessed with becoming really wealthy. Bill Gates, Jeff Bezos, those guys I've gotten to know over the years, they wanted to prove that they could do what they said they want to do. The making of the money comes later. And in my case, I wasn't obsessed with making great sums of money. I wanted to prove that I could do a buyout firm and do something other than practicing law. And we worked hard to make it work. But when the money came, I was as shocked as anybody else. I never expected
it. And they were shocked.
People were shocked.
You and I have a mutual friend who said, if you'd taken a vote in the Carter White House about who was the person who was least likely to make any money whatsoever, you would have won hands down.
I would have. They would have taken the same outcome would have come in my class at Duke, in my class at University of Chicago. Probably they would have said they're the least likely to succeed at Duke, the least likely to succeed at Chicago. But sometimes you know, what I've observed in life, I hate to say this to people here who have probably been student body presidents of colleges or maybe they're first in their class here. It's rarely the case that the people who are the most successful early on always become the most successful later. It sometimes happens, but how many times have you seen somebody first in his or her class in college, first or his or her class in law school, president of the student body, editor-in-chief of the law review, Supreme Court clerk, and then they go on to do great things later?
Be careful.
It happens, but not always. Like, there was a guy in the Carter administration who had the resume that I said, wow, I love this resume. I'll try to protect the name of it, but he went to Harvard. He was the top of his class. He was the editor-in-chief of the Crimson, like a top position. He won a Rhodes Scholarship, got a PhD along the way, went to Yale Law School, editor-in-chief of the Yale Law Journal, Supreme Court clerk, and also a White House fellow and everything else you could do. And when people read his resume in the Carter administration, they kept giving him successively higher positions. Every year he was doing a different position. But he didn't actually spend enough time in any one position to accomplish anything. So at the age of 50, he had done all these great things for 2 years, and then he actually hadn't accomplished anything, and somebody realized that he really wasn't all that accomplished, and his career kind of went this way. There's a thing in the United States called the American Academy of Achievement that probably very few people have heard of, but basically they take young people who have won Rhodes Scholarships and Supreme Court clerkships and Marshall Scholarships, and they give them various awards. And they have an adult category for people who have done distinguished things, Steven Spielberg, George Lucas, or people who have done other great things. And over the 50-year period of time, only about three people were in the younger category who actually made it to the older category. And the point being that sometimes you just don't get to the top. There's a thing at the World Economic Forum, which is Davos, and they have young global leaders. And they pick these people under the age of 40, and these are people who are going to change the world. And I keep telling these young global leaders that the trick is to try to be an old global leader, not a young global leader.
Yeah.
But what happens is you work so hard when you're younger, sometimes you coast on your laurels. And if you struggle when you're younger and you're still proving yourself, it may be a bigger advantage. So I felt I had a lot of advantages by not being in the end, a Supreme Court clerk or a Rhodes Scholar, because had I done so, I might have just said, hey, I'm better than everybody else. I don't have to work that hard.
No, that's undoubtedly the case. So,
I agree.
You know, you're in a room full of high achieving
right.
people, but you know, they want to achieve more.
You have to keep driving, because if you just rest on your laurels, you won't get anywhere, in my view. You've got to keep pushing. And you know, the people who are very accomplished ones, I know people who are now 60, 70, 80, they're still working hard. They're trying to, you know, prove that they're really worth, you know, being on the earth. And I tell people all the time, you've got to figure out in the end, what are you doing on the face of the earth? What is your purpose here? And what are you trying to do to make the world a slightly better place? Now, everybody has their own family concerns, career concerns, but in the end, you've got to focus on what you want to do and kind of make something useful with your life here, because you're here for a short period of time.
How did you answer that question as you were forming Carlyle? I mean, what was it that was...
Well, I can't say that forming a private equity firm would make the world a better place necessarily, but I felt that, you know, if I could build a business in Washington. It could maybe, you know, employ people. We'd make companies more efficient, help the economy, the usual things you would suspect. But I didn't realize the wealth would be such that I would ultimately be in a position to give away enormous sums of money. And when I realized that, I began to say, I made a mistake in the earlier parts of my life by not focusing on these things, and now I'm going to spend the latter part of my life basically giving away all my money. And so I when I turned 54, you know, Forbes had written articles about my partners and my wealth, and so, you know, it was sort of public, and so I realized that I read that a white Jewish male at 54 will live on average another 27 years. I'd lived, therefore, two-thirds of my actuarial expected life. So I said, okay, I can get to the cemetery, and I'll be in my deathbed, and people can say he's got all these money, and he dies with it all. And, you know, I don't really think you need to take it with you in the afterlife. There's no evidence that if you take your money with you and you're buried with it, it really helps you in the afterlife. So I, despite what the pharaohs may have thought. So I decided to give away my money, and when Bill Gates called me and came to have lunch with me, I said, okay, I'll sign the giving pledge. I was the only person in the private equity world who signed the giving pledge, at the initial 40 of us. And today I'm pretty committed to that effort and to try to do things that'll hopefully make the world a slightly better place.
And that pledge is to give half of the wealth?
Well, the pledge is this. You're committed to giving half of your net worth away during the course of your life or upon your death. Now, as any lawyer here can figure out.
Is it a stepped-up basis, or can you use the market value?
Well, you could do that. But as people here are lawyers will figure out, when it says you give away half of your money during your life or upon your death. Well, suppose you give away no money during your life and you keep saying to people, I'm going to give it away upon my death. Then you die and you don't. They can't disinter you and say you're kicked out of the giving pledge movement. Because so it's kind of a voluntary thing. And there are a few people who seem to be like to hang around with Bill Gates and Warren Buffett who haven't given away a lot of money yet. They've signed the giving pledge. Maybe they'll give it away eventually. But so that's what it is. But I've decided to actually give away all of it because I don't really want to burden my children with this enormous amount of money. There's no evidence that if you inherit $1 billion, you're going to do
vote?
Great things. I gave them a very good education, and the only thing that you can really do for a child is to give them unconditional love by your parents and get from parents. And that's what you can do. You support your children, but, you know, if I know all of you will laugh, but if you were going to inherit $1 billion tomorrow, do you actually think you would have the same drive if you didn't? You know, I think inheriting the money is not all that wonderful. Bill Gates told me he's essentially going to give his kids no money. And, you know, that his situation is different than mine. But you know, giving your kids no money if you're Bill Gates is complicated. But are those kids really going to be better off if they inherit all that money? Inherited wealth is really complicated. And I'm not sure it's a great thing for kids. And it screws them up as much as helps them, I think.
So let's talk about the private equity world,
sure.
And how it's developed and changed over time, and then you caught a gust of wind. It seems
right.
The timing was right, and you were
yes.
Hooked to it. You were great at it. So how did that work?
Luck is another word, but look, here private equity in essence is essentially this. It's a method by which professionals get compensated quite generously to improve or start or enhance the value of companies. It really started, I like to say, Christopher Columbus was the first private equity person. He had a percentage of the profits of all the money he got when he came to the New World, but there was no money, so he didn't really do that well. But ultimately, the private equity business as we know it today was started in the mid-60s, let's say, by venture capital firms in the East and West Coast. They raised very small funds, and they changed the way money managers were compensated. A money manager who manages money for somebody else, historically over hundreds of years of period of time, they would get paid a management fee, 1% or whatever it was. These people said, what we're going to do is get a management fee, but not on money we're managing, but on money that's committed to us. We might not even actually have it yet. Will you pay us money, a fee in advance for us to look at deals? But then their real innovation was to say, we're going to get 20% of the profits. So-called carried interest in what the investment would be. And by getting 20% of the profits of somebody else's money, if you're very good, you can make staggering sums. And so the venture firms, the early venture firms in the 60s did quite well. And then the buyout people came along and said, well, we have a different thing. We're not going to start companies. We're going to buy troubled companies or companies that are underperforming. We'll borrow a lot of money. In the early days, 99% of the money, and they put in 1% of the equity. And then they'd make these companies more efficient. They'd sell them and make a lot of money. It was a mom and pop business because the partnership agreement said you had to spend 100% of your time managing the money that you were entrusted with. What I did to change the private equity world, and anybody that's going to grow a company and make it successful has to do something somebody else hasn't done. If you're just copycatting somebody else, in the end, you won't get very far. Everybody that has built a great company has done something in that big company that makes that changes the business dramatically. So what we did is this. I decided to ignore the rules and basically say to the people who made the rules, I'm sorry, rather than ask their permission. And what I meant was this. Rather than have this small fund, we had a buyout fund, and I was supposed to spend 100% of my time managing it with my partners, I decided to let them manage it, and I would go out and build an institution like Fidelity or Vanguard or T. Rowe Price, where I had many funds managing much more money, but a different fund for every different segment. So buyouts, Europe buyouts, growth capital, venture capital, leveraged debt, distressed debt, whatever it would be. And so we decided to build an infrastructure in Washington, the back office, all the accounting, the tax and so forth, administration, fundraising, and then have professionals running these things. And so that enabled us to institutionalize the business by having so many different funds, and we weren't just going to be a one-fund mom-and-pop business. And then we decided to globalize it by going around the world and doing this around the world. And that's what enabled us to go from $5 million to $200 billion. And we've now invested $106 billion over the years with a gross internal rate of return of 30% per year. So, you know, if you put your money in your bank, you get 0.5% if you're lucky, maybe. We average 30% a year for 27 years. So obviously when the word goes forth that you've done that, more and more money comes in. But that's how we did it. We changed the face of the private equity world, and we had a good track record.
And I think I read or I've heard you said that you're now trying to open it up to the sort of the common investor.
Yes. Well, most the people who put money up for private equity initially were the high net worth people, the Rockefellers, the Hillmans, the Whitneys. And then in 1978, in the Carter administration, I had nothing to do with it, the Department of Labor said that for ERISA funds, it is now would be considered okay for under the prudent man rule to allow ERISA funds to go into private equity. And so the big state pension funds, which was the biggest source of capital in the United States, first with Oregon and then Washington, other states, started putting in enormous sums into these funds, and they grew exponentially. In 1980, the entire amount of money devoted to private equity in the world, committed to private equity in 1980, was $3 billion. Today, it's roughly $2.5 trillion. So it's obviously grown dramatically. And that's in large part because public pension funds, now sovereign wealth funds, come in. So they've been the big investors. But individual investors who are tired of getting 0.5% if they get that in their bank accounts are saying increasingly, I would like to get into private equity investing. If the other people can get 30% gross returns and maybe 20% net, why can't I do it? Now, it's harder to do and not that easy to have individual investors come in. We have a rule in the United States that says if you're an individual investor, you want to invest in private equity, which isn't necessarily approved by the SEC in terms of reviewing the documents, you have to be an accredited investor, which means more or less you have $250,000 of net income and about $1 million of net worth. Now, it's a strange rule in some respects, because if you are an idiot and you inherit $100 million and you're just a boob, you can take that $100 million and piss it away in any bad private equity. If you go to the best college in the United States, you're summa cum laude in economics and finance, but you go to Teach for America and you're making $30,000 a year, you're not allowed to invest in private equity because it's too dangerous for you. And although you need the higher rate of return because you're making a lower income, you're not allowed to do that. Now, gradually, the people in Washington are saying that doesn't make sense, so we're going to figure out a way to let people with lower incomes who have, with certain standards, invest in private equity. So what a lot of our firms are doing are now raising funds from individual investors in certain ways that are legally okay, but today, gradually, 401ks and IRAs will have a checkoff, and you can check off going into a Blackstone or Carlyle TPG fund, so you can open to democratize, in effect, private equity, and that's what will happen.
So, maybe we'll come back to that in a second here. Can we talk about the economy and how?
Sure.
Well, so you were here a few years ago when we were very worried about what was happening in this country. It was 2008, and you were on a panel here,
right,
and with several panels actually. And now I don't know. How do you see it? Are we through that period? Are we still dealing with it?
Well,
what happened?
Right. What happened was we have recessions in the United States roughly every 7 years, and they last on average 9 months. So it wasn't unusual to have a recession. People didn't anticipate that the subprime debt crisis would force the recession. But it turns out that subprime was just the tip of the iceberg. People were overlevered. People were borrowing way too much money. And when the economy slows down, it's a self-fulfilling problem. You can't pay off the debt, and things begin to go down very quickly. We had a recession in 2008 and 9 that was the biggest since the Great Depression. The Great Recession lasted not on 9 months, but you could say almost 2 years. And actually, even today, although the recession technically ended in June of 2009 in the United States, we really haven't completely recovered from it, because today we have these residual results. Number one, we ran up enormous amounts of government debt, and we still have those. We have almost $20 trillion of federal debt now, and not to mention about $70 trillion of unfunded liabilities for Social Security, Medicare, and Medicaid. But we have $20 trillion of debt. A large part of that came in, more than half of that came in the last 6 or 7 years. So that's still with us. We still have a fundamental structural deficit of roughly $500 billion a year. Under the president's budget, the new budget, he's proposing a deficit of about $500 billion. And he's saying that we can get rid of the austerity now because we've solved our problem. But we have a big structural deficit, and we're going to keep running up these deficits for quite some time. Another problem that's arisen is that when people started losing their jobs in the Great Recession, people who are 50 and older were being fired. They are not being rehired as much as they used to be, and so a lot of them have retired. Younger people who used to get a job out of college, now they go live with their parents, and they do one of two things, one of which I'll tell you, you won't believe, and maybe some of you will. A lot of parents, in order to get their kids out of the house, will say, go find an internship. You know, don't get paid. Just get out of the house, go work somewhere, an internship. And people are taking unpaid jobs out of college now because young people aren't being hired as regularly as before. Another phenomenon, the one that I was referring to, is this. Some parents are saying to employers, I will pay you to hire my child. I will pay you to give them an internship just to get them out of the house, get them some training. And so the problem is that we have very few people working compared to what we should have. Normally in the United States, you have 66% of adults in the workforce. Now we have about 62%. So the reason the unemployment level is said to be 5.6%, lower than it's been for a while, is because we have a very small percentage of people, smaller than before, in the workforce. So we have this structural unemployment problem that's still with us. And then the greatest problem that came about as a result of the recession is still with us, and it's getting worse, and it's called income inequality. The rich are getting richer, and the poor are getting poorer. They're not going anywhere. And another problem related to that is social mobility, which is a different problem. Income inequality, you maybe can figure out how to deal with it eventually. Social mobility means the people at the bottom don't feel they can get to the top. When I was at the bottom, I felt I could work hard and get to the top. Many people at the bottom today, particularly minorities, do not feel they can get to the top, and they've given up. And that is a really fundamental problem. So we're technically out of the recession, but we have structural problems that came about as a result of the recession, and we're going to be with them for a while. The economy, as stated, you know, is we have two different ways to measure the economy. We have certain standard ways, and by those standard ways, we're doing okay. GDP is going to grow about 3.5% this year, about that percentage last year. Inflation's under 2%, really under 1.5%. Unemployment seems to be low. But these are numbers, and corporate profits are higher than ever. But these statistics are masking what's happening in the underclass, because wages and real wages are not going up in the United States. Real wages are going down. And when real wages go down, that means that, you know, you don't really have a middle class that's as viable as it should be. You know, President Obama may have reflected some of the unfamiliarity with this a bit. When he campaigned for president the first time, he said, I'm not going to increase taxes on the middle class. Well, nobody wants to increase tax on the middle class, right? Because the middle class is where all the voters are. So he said, so therefore, if you make $250,000 or more, or less, I'm sorry, you're not going to be taxed. Thinking that all of his friends made $250,000 and they're kind of middle class. Well, it turns out that for the family of four in the United States, the median income is about $65,000. So if you're really talking about people in the middle class, it's $65,000. And therefore, when the president said later in his administration, we're not going to tax anybody who is $250,000 and below, you eliminate 98% of the taxpayers. So you only are dealing with the top 2% when you're increasing taxes. There aren't enough billionaires and multimillionaires in that 2% to really solve all these problems. You've got to tax the middle class, and if you're not willing to do that, we're going to continue these problems for quite some time. The only way out of it is far greater economic growth, and we're growing at a reasonable pace, better than Europe and better than Japan, but not at the pace we need to grow out of these problems.
So if in 2012, the president had said, now's your chance to be the director of domestic.
Well, inflate the economy again. That's what I did before. And you inflate the economy, you can pay off this debt. But the only way to solve, there's no easy answer. And Durham doesn't seem as bad as Washington or New York. Anybody ever driven in a road in Washington or New York recently? Ever seen the potholes there? I mean, I've been in Lagos, Nigeria, with much better roads than we have in Washington. It's an embarrassment. So what we need to do, and if it was so easy, I would be in elective office or I'd be trying to solve these problems. It's not that easy. But the only way to solve the income inequality and social mobility problem is education. You've got to educate the people who are not getting educations. And today in Washington, D.C., where I live, 25% of the people who enter the public high schools do not graduate from high school. If you don't graduate from high school, you're obviously going to earn a lower amount. You have a greater chance of being part of the criminal justice system. 12% of the people in the United States, 12% of the adults in this country, are completely and totally illiterate. Completely and totally. 20% are functionally illiterate. They can read a stop sign, they can sign their name, but they really can't read. So with these kind of statistics, you aren't going to solve your income inequality problem until you really get people educated and motivated to do better. And it's a long-term problem. We didn't get into it overnight, and we're not going to solve it overnight. Now, if you look at the macro numbers, you know, people will say the U.S. economy is doing well, but we're building a bigger and bigger underclass that isn't going to be able to, I think, get to the top. And the result is we're going to have really two Americas, and that one on the top will be doing great. The one on the bottom is going to be doing much worse than we've had before. And as I think most people know, statistics now show, surveys, that now, for the first time, Americans think that their children will have a lower standard of living than they did. And historically, you've always had the opposite.
What about Europe and Asia as compared to the U.S.?
Right. Europe, yeah, I always say if you want to have a good vacation, if you want a good meal, you want to see a great museum, Europe is the greatest place in the world. They're living in the 19th century. United States is sort of in the 20th century, and Asia is in the 21st century. I don't know if Europe can get out of the 19th century. Well, think about this. Of all the social net spending, social net, which means money to help people who have income inequality issues. All the social net spending in the world, 50% of it is spent in Western Europe, but it's only 5% of the population. So they have work rules, they have social nets that are so expensive, but they can't afford them any longer. So Europe's problem is that when I was growing up, there was Eastern Europe and Western Europe. Now there's Southern Europe and Northern Europe. And Northern Europe doesn't want to pay for Southern Europe's, they would say, not high work style and social network. So the Germans are very upset, and they got, you know, they really are upset with what the ECB is doing now to kind of have quantitative easing. So I think you've got serious problems in Europe. Europe will grow at not 3.5%, but maybe 0.5% this year. They have a serious deflation problem, and deflation is a much more serious problem than inflation. We all know how to solve inflation. You ratchet up interest rates, and you get rid of inflation. With deflation, we don't really know how to solve it, and they are really worried about deflation. So I think Europe has some real structural problems, and they are probably 10 years to be solved before they go. Now, Asia is in a different situation. Asia is the future, and just think about this. When we talk about the developed markets, it's really United States, Western Europe, Japan, let's say Australia, New Zealand. They are now 15% of the world's population. 85% of the world's population is in the so-called emerging markets, and now they have 55% of the GDP. And they are going to dramatically increase their percentage of GDP. In 1960, the United States was 46% of the world's GDP, almost half the world's GDP in one country. Now we're about 18% and sinking. So the greatest growth opportunities and investment opportunities are in the so-called emerging markets. China and India, among others, are where more and more investment dollars are going to go. China is a country that has grown at 10% a year for 30 years in a row. In the history of the world, no country ever grew at 10% a year for 30 years in a row. Now they're growing at a lower percentage, probably 7.5%. But even 7.5% of an economy that's about $10 trillion is still very significant. So they're adding more to the world's GDP than we are because they're growing at a faster rate, and their economy is not technically bigger than ours. By purchase price parity, they are bigger than we are. By GDP, they're not. But they will pass us into my lifetime in GDP. So China and India are great growth stories and great places to invest, and it's very difficult for us to compete with them. We can, but it's more complicated than it used to be.
What about Japan? The Japanese should be very interested in what you can do.
Japan, think about this. The average age in the United States is 36. Average age in Europe is 41. Average age in China is 34. Average age in Latin America is 29. Average age in sub-Saharan Africa is 18. The average age in Japan is 45. They have the oldest age in the world on average. 23% of the people in Japan are 65 or older. The equivalent number in the United States is 13%. So you've got almost a quarter of the population 65 or older in Japan, and you have the highest percentage of people in the world who are 100 or over in Japan. So it's a very healthy place to live. But the problem is you have young people are not reproducing. And they tell the Japanese businessmen, do not go out drinking at night, go home and reproduce. But but the Japanese men by survey say they are really interested more out in more interested in drinking with their colleagues and advancing their career than going home and reproducing, which is a sad phenomenon, you would say. But the result is that Japan, it is amazing that they're the third biggest economy in the world, and they were the second biggest for a while, and we thought at one point they would overtake us. They have about roughly 120 million people. But for a population to stay stable, a woman has to reproduce on average 2.1 children. In Japan, they're producing 1.4. So their population is going down, and they have no immigration. So they have a real serious problem, and deflation has been one of them. I don't know how they're going to solve their demographic problem. They either have to inflate their economy dramatically or let more people into the economy. I think they have the most serious demographic problems in the world, next to Russia, probably.
So let's talk about Duke a bit.
Okay.
So you're
all right.
Got a little time. You're chair of the board of trustees, and that's a great honor and a great opportunity. You're part of the leadership group. You know, if you were to approach it as you might a company
right.
you're doing in it, you know, what are the strategic opportunities okay. for Duke University?
Well, let me answer the first this way. When I decided to devote myself to philanthropy a bit, I decided what I would do is spend half my time on my business and half my time on my philanthropy. And I do philanthropy in three ways. One, giving away money to places that I think are useful and try to monitor it and make sure the money is used effectively. Second was to help them raise money. I'd be willing to ask people for money, so I chair a lot of capital campaigns, the co-chair of the Duke one and the Harvard one and the Council on Foreign Relations, Smithsonian, and so forth, but also to serve on boards and actually be actively involved, not just writing checks. So I got involved in a lot of boards, and I am on an awful lot of nonprofit boards, and I enjoy it, or I wouldn't be on them. At Duke, and like other places, if you get to be in a position where you're the chair, you can say, I'm going to preside over these meetings, and I can run the meetings and make them interesting, or you can actually make the organization much better. I'm not interested in presiding. At this point, I'm old enough to say I've got all the honors I want, I have all the people patting me on the back. I'm not interested in that. I want to actually change something and make it much better. So when I became the chair of the board, I sat down with Dick Broadhead, the president, who's a man I obviously respect, or I wouldn't have done this job, and said, look, Dick, I'm happy that, you know, that I'm chairman, but I have 50 things I want to accomplish, and here's the list. And let's go over my 4 years as chairman. Let's go through these, and let's try to get them done. So I think his jaw dropped because, you know, usually chairman don't say, here's 50 things I want to do. So I went through, and I'm working my way through this list, and I'll get some of them done, like more than I thought, not all of them. But I am trying to change the university in some ways. Now, one person can only have a limited impact. I'm one person. I'm the chairman of the board. I'm not here full-time and so forth. And I have to remember that the university is run by the administrators. It's not really run by the deans. It's not really run by people on the board. But I'm trying to make sure that Duke has the resources to be competitive with other schools that are comparable, that Duke is a place that students want to come to and enjoy it when they come here and actually learn something, and they feel that they are indebted to the university, so when they leave for the next 40 or 50 years of their life, they will feel an attachment to university, because most universities raise the bulk of their money from people who are alums or people who went there. And I also want to make sure that we have the resources, the physical resources and the intellectual resources, to be competitive with other schools. And Duke has probably advanced as much as any school in the last 40 years that I know of, with one exception. I think the two schools have probably done more than anything over the last 40 years to advance themselves. One is Stanford, where you went to law school, and the other is Duke. And they are very comparable. When I'm trying to do something that's going to bring them together, I took the entire Duke board to Stanford a year or so ago to show them what Stanford has done. Stanford has resources that are beyond Duke's in many ways, and they have some other advantages. But we have some advantages over them. We are smaller, and we have, I think, a better culture in many ways. But Stanford's a great school. And so I'm trying to say to people, what we're trying to do at Duke and what Stanford's trying to do is say, let's have a great American university which has first-class students, first-class faculty in a beautiful setting, and it can show that you can actually have first-class academics and first-class athletics, and create an environment where people are happy to go to school and don't emerge neurotic. Many schools, there are some schools that are very good, but the students mostly, you know, they emerge somewhat neurotic, and they hate the school afterwards. So I am trying to find a place where, and I'm trying to help make Duke be a place where people actually enjoy it. They're proud to be here, and when they leave, they want their children to go here. They want their friends to go here. And, you know, we're not going to be Harvard overnight. We're not going to be University of Chicago. We're not going to be Stanford overnight. But we have a culture that's very distinctive. It's one we should be proud of. And Duke has pulled itself up from its bootstraps from a relatively modest base. Remember, we were a segregated school in 1962 in the Deep South. And now we are one of the lead universities in the United States. If you look at the U.S. News rankings, no university is more highly ranked than us that has a smaller endowment. So there are a lot of very good schools that are very competitive with Duke, but none in the U.S. News rankings, which has a smaller endowment, is more highly ranked. Some of the schools that are more highly ranked than us have been around for 200 years more than we have been. So Duke has done very well to come from where it has gone. But if we say, hey, we're really great, we have great resources, we have to sit on our laurels, we'll just fall behind. So it's like a business. You have to say, what can you do to take advantage of your resources, play to your strengths, and try to get everybody to pull together. The most important thing in a business is the culture of the company. And the most important thing in a university has to be the culture. The culture has to pull together and be a healthy one, or the university won't get where it's going to be, or should go.
So we have a very healthy culture, I think.
I think it is.
Fair to say. Do you see the triangle as an important opportunity?
Well, Terry Sanford started, in effect, helped to start the research triangle, and I think he did a very good job. But remember, that was in the early 70s, or mid-70s. You have to recognize that it's very binary in the venture capital technology world. There is Silicon Valley, and there's everything else. And there is nothing comparable to Silicon Valley. You can take the other three best, and they're not even close to Silicon Valley together. So Silicon Valley is unique. I think the research triangle can be one of the important players below Silicon Valley. We're not going to overcome Silicon Valley for lots of reasons in our lifetime. But I think the research triangle can do enormous things because of the three great universities. And I think a lot of people increasingly want to stay here. One of Stanford's strengths is that people like it's seductive. You went out there and you stayed in California. A lot of people like to stay out there.
But I didn't stay
in Silicon Valley.
On the peninsula. Now, you know, it's become so crowded and expensive. So
true. But a lot of people love to stay out there. Now, historically, people would come to Duke and say, okay, when can I get out of Durham?
That's changed.
It's changed. And now, when I went to Duke undergraduate, there were two pizza parlors and one Chinese restaurant downtown, and that was basically it. Nobody went off campus. Now it's a food capital. Now it's a great place to retire. Now it's a great place to live, and you have a very high percentage of PhDs in this area, maybe the highest in the country. So it's an attractive area. I am involved in the entrepreneurship and innovation program at Duke and trying to make it more of an entrepreneurial culture, but I think it takes time. And Duke is in really good shape, but we need more resources and more attention to it.
So let's talk about the philanthropy a bit, because you've sort of specialized in one sense in patriotic philanthropy, civic philanthropy.
Yeah.
Why don't you talk?
Let me explain that. Philanthropy is an ancient Greek word that means loving humanity. It doesn't mean rich people writing checks. So I tell people, you can help people, but with your ideas or your time or your energy. So I think that Wendy Kopp, who created Teach for America and didn't have any money to put into it, is a great philanthropist. She really helped the country, did great things to help other people, but she didn't write checks. So we bastardized the word philanthropy a bit. So I dislike it when the great philanthropists listed people who how much money they gave away. That shouldn't be the only measure. In my own case, I decided that I would give away a bulk of my money, and I pick areas to do it, universities and education and arts and culture and humanities. But the bulk of my money goes to medical research and education. But because so many other people do that, what I do in that area doesn't get that much attention. So like if I told you I created a center for pancreatic cancer at Sloan Kettering, you would say, I didn't know that. Because lots of people do things in cancer and it doesn't get that much attention. But what has gotten the most attention is because nobody else is doing it, I guess, is what I've called or coined the phrase patriotic philanthropy. And what I mean by that is trying to give to the U.S. government things to help them remind people of how great this country is with its flaws, but still how great it is, and remind them of our tradition. So I got into that by happenstance. Most great things in life happen by happenstance. If you hire McKinsey to do a study for 9 months on what you should do, you'll probably get the wrong answer. By happenstance, I happened to be in New York. Somebody told me, invited me to a reception. The reception was to see the Magna Carta. I said, well, the Magna Carta is one Magna Carta from 1215. What's it doing in here, and what's it doing at Sotheby's? I get there, and it turns out that there are 17 extant copies of the Magna Carta from different versions of it, and that 15 of them are in British institutions, one is in the Australian Parliament, and Ross Perot had bought one in 1981 from a British family that had it in its possession for 500 years. They were land poor, they were going to lose their land unless they sold something. They sold this Magna Carta to him for about $1.5 million. He sent his lawyer over to pick it up. Lawyer goes over there, rolls it up in a little tube, and comes back through customs, and British customs agent apparently said, well, what's in that tube? He says, the Magna Carta. And the guy says, okay, fine, you can leave. He didn't believe him. He thought it was a joke. Anyway, he put it on display at the National Archives for a while, and Ross Perot got in a fight, I think, with the National Archives people, and ultimately decided to put it up for sale. And this curator at Sotheby's said it's going to go to somebody from outside the United States. Probably I knew who the likely winners are because I knew who the prospective people are who are interested. And a light bulb went off my head. And if I thought about it for an hour, I wouldn't have maybe done it. I said, this is the inspiration for the Declaration of Independence, the Bill of Rights, the Constitution. There's 17 copies. One should be in the United States. So I said, I'm going to come back tomorrow and buy it. And I didn't want to tell my wife. It sounds a little presumptuous to say I'm going to go buy the Magna Carta tomorrow. And I didn't want to tell my children. They might say, well, how much less money might this mean for us? So I didn't do that. So I went back. I don't collect art, so I didn't know Sotheby's. I went there. They put me in a little room. I started bidding, and all of a sudden, the guy comes in and says, you won. And then he said, who are you? We never heard of you. And I explained to him. He said, okay, all right, you have the money for this? I said, yes. He said, okay. He said, you can go out, and nobody will ever know who bought it, or you can tell these 100 reporters who want to know who bought the Magna Carta. So I went out and said, look, I'm going to put it on a permanent display at the National Archives, and then when I die, it'll go there forever. I have it on permanent loan, but then when I die, it'll go there. And I want to do that as a down payment on my obligation to repay the country for the great fortune I've had. And because I came from very modest circumstances, I now have the ability to do these things. I want to repay the country, so I want the country to have this. And then I got in the habit of buying other historic documents, the Declaration of Independence, the Emancipation Proclamation, the 13th Amendment. So the Emancipation Proclamation I put in the Oval Office with the President. Declaration of Independence, I've given them to the Smithsonian and the State Department and other places. And the purpose of this is not to say how great I am to have done this. It's to remind people of American history, its flaws and its good things, and get people to think more about it because so few people know about our country's history. It turns out that when you do a survey, that Pew did a survey not long ago of Americans, and they asked, what river did George Washington cross during the Revolutionary War? 30% of the people said the Rhine River, which is not in our country. 35% of the people, when asked who was the first Treasury Secretary, said Larry Summers. And it turns out in a high school sophomore survey, a nationwide survey, that more high school sophomores could name the first three names of the Three Stooges than the first three names of any founding fathers. So it just drives home that we should learn more about American history, and that's one of the things I try to do. And the other one is try to fix certain things. I mean, the Washington Monument had its earthquake damage. I said, I'll put up the money to fix it, and I did. And then ultimately try to fix Montpelier, which is James Madison's home, Monticello, which is Thomas Jefferson's home, Mount Vernon, George Washington's home, recently the Custis Lee Mansion, and some others that will be announced soon. So I try to fix up things to remind people of these historic things that happened in our country. And, you know, I don't want to eliminate the bad things. And when I put up money to fix Monticello and Montpelier and the Custis Lee Mansion at Arlington, I insisted that the slave quarters be built out because I want to remind people that, you know, our founding fathers were slave owners. One-third of them were slave owners. We should remember the good and the bad and so forth. And so that's one of the things I try to do. And I call it patriotic philanthropy, but I hate that in a sense because I don't want to make people think that I'm more of a patriot than somebody else because I do this. You know, patriotism is in the eye of the beholder. And obviously the people who serve in the armed forces and give up their lives are the true patriots. The people who are writing checks or doing these kind of things are nice, but I wouldn't say it's quite as the same as serving in Iraq or Afghanistan. But that's what I'm trying to do.
So, David, thank you for coming today. Right. We could go on for a very long time. Do you regret not becoming a dentist?
When I do go to the dentist, yes, I do. I could understand what he's saying much better, but yes.
Yeah. Well, this is your law school, and I'd just like to say you are responsible for it, and we really...
I want to thank you for the great job you've done as dean, because I know very few people give up federal lifetime appointments as a judge to become a dean of a law school, and I appreciate the great job you've done here as dean, and the rankings have gone up, fundraising has gone up, I think the student morale has gone up, the number of clerkships have gone up, Supreme Court clerkships and other things, and so thank you for the job you've done for Duke.
And thank you. And everybody, thank you.